Good evening. This should be a moment in television history, because this program will bring together more places throughout the world than has ever been possible before. Live pictures from across the world will be brought to us here in Britain. At the same time, they will reach millions of viewers in 24 different countries throughout the world. For some people watching, it will be the evening as it is for us. For some, it will be breakfast time. For others, the middle of the day. For others, the middle of the night. This program would not have been possible before 1967. Europe was joined to America by satellite across the Atlantic in 1962. But the link across the Pacific was not completed until 1966. This evening, by using satellites, microwaves, and landlines, we will link Europe with Africa, Asia, Australia, and America. Our world was going to circle the globe for the first time. Now, it won't quite do that, because for political reasons, the Russians and a few other countries have withdrawn. It's a pity, but there it is, and now we can cover two-thirds instead of all the world. We're sorry to have lost this absolute completeness, and if at some time in the future our colleagues do feel able to rejoin us, we will, of course, welcome them. Even so, with two-thirds of the world to cover, we have more than enough. Here in Britain, as well as receiving the programme, we're also contributing to it. We will look at the exciting new town of Cumbernauld, and from London, the still unconquerable Beatles. Other countries contributing to this programme from around the world will, of course, use their own language. But to help us understand the foreign reporters, we have Corbett Woodall, Merrill O'Keefe, and Tim Gudgeon. They'll be listening to and giving you an English translation. One thing we must make clear, in the next 2 hours, everything will be live, no film or recording. Five-sevenths ocean, two-sevenths land. 135 sovereign countries, the home of 3,400 million people. And tonight, for the first time, we can see right round our world from sunset to dawn by television. Television stations in 14 countries all round the world have joined up to make one program, this program. In 43 control rooms all round the world, production teams are monitoring and selecting the hundreds of pictures and sounds from five continents which will combine to make this historic program. At St. Paul de Vence in France, they are preparing for a visit from Chagall and Miro in one of the world's most novel artistic centers, the Fondation Maite. And at Cape Kennedy in the United States of America, cameras are already looking at Saturn V rocket, which has started its countdown. And in London, their recording studio, where the Beatles are in the middle of a recording session. These people and places are just a few of the ingredients in our programme. And here in London, England, is the centre of the web, the control room of the whole programme. From here, it goes out to something like 170 million television sets in 24 countries. This is our world. There are a million things to say about it, but there is one which, more than all the others, will determine the future of our children and our grandchildren. It is this. 100 years ago, there were 1,000 million people on our world. 40 years ago, there were 2,000 million. At this moment, there are over 3,000 million. By the year 2000, there will be 7,000 million. We can represent the crowded, expanding world by charts and maps and symbols, but none of us have ever seen it, at least not as a whole. But tonight, we can look round the world at what we really mean when we talk about expanding population. We start this program by looking at some of the very newest arrivals in our world, babies who joined our human family in the last few minutes. Our first quick look across the world begins in Japan, in the land of the rising sun.
Indeed, it is the land of the rising sun on Monday morning at 4 minutes past 4 a.m. A quiet morning in Sapporo. And here we have the University Hospital of Hokkaido at Sapporo. My name is Seigo Kitade, and this baby was born 27 minutes ago exactly. He is the first son of the family of Kamakura, and he weighs 3 kilograms and 50 grams. His footprints have been taken. This is a Japanese custom. Televiewers all over the world are seeing this child.
Now we are in Denmark at Aarhus, 1 hour before sunset, Sunday evening, a day of wind and sunshine. Your reporter is Ola Andiasen in the maternity hospital in Aarhus in Denmark, a maternity hospital attached to the university, like the one you saw in Sapporo, Japan. Here is another Dane added to the 4.5 million population of Denmark, a little girl weighing 3,040 grams. She's well supplied for hair. There's another world-famous newborn baby.
This is the monument to the Mexican race in Mexico City. This monument was built in 1960, and to the west is number 3 maternity hospital of the Mexican Institute of Social Security. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Berro Baris speaking to you. In Mexico City, which will be the seat of the 1972 Olympic Games, 68 Olympic Games, and we are attending a birth. Dr. Victor Espinosa Reyes is attending. And this is the baby. This is a live transmission. The parents are very happy because the child is perfectly normal and robust, as you can see. This child will be called Mundo.
Mundo in English, world.
3,000 miles to the north, here in Edmonton, Canada, is the Charles Camsell Hospital, glistening in the sun. This is a hospital strictly for the Indians and Eskimos of northern Canada, the Arctic coast, and the Arctic islands. I'm Libby Christensen. It's now 7 minutes past noon here, and just behind me, a mother is seeing her child for the very first time. Aki Nita Wagat Wasis. A child has been born, a Cree Indian baby. Her mother and father are Cree Indians of the Big Stone Band. The baby's name is Debbie Laurie Oje, and she has the jet black hair of her ancestors. She weighs 8 pounds, 12 ounces. And in a few days, Debbie will fly north to join her 8 brothers and sisters. The first year of life for Debbie in the rugged North Bush country will be the hardest, but she should live to be 60 years of age. Debbie Ogier, the latest baby born here in a country 100 years old this year.
Four babies, one shown to us at the very moment of birth, shown to us all round the world, but only four out of some 1,800 born in the few minutes since this program began. Four whose lives are likely to be lived out worlds apart, born at a moment in history when it's first possible to see round the planet for the first time. The sun lights up only half the globe, but television can beat the sun. Our cameras can be where it is morning and afternoon, dawn and sunset, today and tomorrow, and all at the press of a button. The dawn creeps round the equator at a mere 1,000 miles an hour, but our pictures flash round at 186,000 miles a second. It's a summer evening in Paris, a winter morning in Melbourne, just before lunch in Vancouver, the middle of the afternoon in New York. Tonight, the world becomes smaller than it's ever been. Until 140 years ago, no one could travel very far. For Magellan in 1518, a journey around the world meant 3 years of his life. When Hugo Eckner took the Graf Zeppelin around the world in 3 weeks in 1929, he reduced it to this size, and in 1961, Yuri Gagarin orbited in just 90 minutes and made it this much smaller. And today, our journey across the globe through a network of landlines and microwave links and ground stations and satellites takes just about 2 seconds, and distance ceases almost to have meaning. The television journey we're starting now is one that nobody has ever taken before. We shall see what our neighbours are doing at this very moment in different places round our world. First of all, the Earth itself. This is our world, a photograph taken from a satellite. Somewhere on this indistinct circle, there are over 3,000 million people who are working, playing, sleeping, or watching this picture. And now we come down to Earth for our journey into tomorrow, and we begin just a few minutes past 8 of a summer evening, Sunday evening, in the heart of Europe.
Ten minutes past 8 at Linz in Austria. Here at the United Austrian Iron and Steel Works, only another hour and 15 minutes before the night shift takes over. That's Alois Lehner over there, directing the crane which is pouring molten pig iron into that vessel. Within 20 minutes, it will be changed into high-proof steel. Alois Lehner was already present, and so were many of his colleagues, when 14 years ago, in this very place, the first ton of hard steel was manufactured here. The second crane here was filled just 18 minutes ago and is now being emptied.
Westwards again, across Europe to the capital city of France. Paris on a Sunday evening.
Ici Paris, c'est Joseph Pasteur qui vous parle.
This is Paris, Joseph Pasteur. It's 8:11 and 40 seconds, the weather's fine. And as on every Sunday, the delicate task is now being taken on of getting all the cars home in the sunshine. We can hear what he says to his colleagues. Nothing escapes the observation of the helicopter. He has a perfect view of all the gates in Paris, particularly that of La Chapelle, which is where we are, which gives the best possible access to Paris because of its 15 roads. Now circulation is slightly loose. Most of the cars come from the north. They've spent the Sunday in Chantilly, they went on the motorway, and now they start slowing down because very soon they'll have to choose the particular road leading to their homes. Coming back to Paris on a Sunday evening, particularly when the weather's been tremendously good, as it's been today, always poses serious problems of traffic. A tremendous number of cars this evening, the west wind is fairly strong. It's a bit awkward for the helicopter. But whatever may be the weather conditions, it will always remain there until it has to go.
Nearly 1,000 miles south from France and on to our next continent. From Europe, now across the Mediterranean to Africa to Tunis.
Tunis, the eternal city of a glorious past, built on the birthplace of Carthage. Mohammed Maite is the name of the reporter. It's 8:15 and the weather's fine. Let's have a look round Tunis. A magnificent city. Look at the minarets and the architecture. A town with a terrific past and yet turning its eyes to the future as well. See the Muslims going through the narrow streets on their way to the mosque. This is the souk. Girl walking through the streets as the girls have walked through the streets for centuries now. And yet a woman interested in today's problems. There you saw the modern woman, today's generation. This is where the past meets the present. The town looks to the future. A town of craftsmen, architecture, styling, the heart of Tunis.
East and north now for our last stop on this side of the Atlantic. We move 900 miles from Tunis, skirting the coast of North Africa, to the Gulf of Cadiz.
Spanish television from the sea, near the mouth of the Guadalquivir. Half an hour from sunset. Spain is a maritime country. Its fishing industry was one of the first in the world. Its modern deep fishing fleet go across the seas, as did the navigators and the discoverers. The Spanish fish industry is one of the best in Europe. From near here, the first trip around the world was started, opening new horizons to the men. The deep sea fishing fleet going about its daily tasks, a scene which has been repeated daily for centuries without change. Each day, the fisherman hauls in the net. It's always different, and this is what it's like today. Fishing is one of the main industries and sources of wealth in the villages on this part of a tourist-ridden coast. While nations developing so rapidly, there are still corners like this where you can still find peace and human dignity in the service of a type of gastronomy so rare nowadays.
Europe, Africa, the Atlantic. Now we move 3,000 miles across the Atlantic to visit our third continent, to America.
This town, until 3 days ago, was distinguished only by its anonymity. A flat, slumbering farm town suddenly jolted awake. I'm Dick McCutcheon of NET. It is now 3:17 p.m. And almost exactly 90 minutes ago, American President Johnson and Soviet Premier Kosygin entered this house to resume their meeting on the summit in this, the unrarefied atmosphere of Glassboro. Just as the resources of international television have been mustered for this program, Our World, so the bewildering hardware of American communications has descended on this small rural community. And it's difficult to determine which Glassboro finds more complex: the enormous issues of the summit meeting itself, or the technology that accompanies it.
Using some of that technology now, from the Atlantic coast of America, we travel 2,000 miles west to Canada, to the province of Alberta.
From the tension of world diplomacy to peaceful reality here at Two Rivers Ranch, the Alberta foothills, where at 12:18, the cowboys have returned to work from their noonday meal to continue cutting out, which is the selection of animals from the herd. That's Randy Dunham, the ranch foreman, riding King Leo Barr, a cutting horse which is valued at $100,000 and is considered to be one of the finest sires of his breed in the world. Randy Dunham pretty well grew up with horses and, in fact, started cowboying when he was 15 years old. Now at 39 and holder of the 1965 Canadian Cutting Horse Championship for four-year-olds, he devotes himself to the breeding and training of these remarkable horses. A cutting horse is a highly trained specialist who works to a pattern of movement as intricate as the ballet. Today, because of the requirements of the cattlemen, the animal reflects in appearance and action the purpose for which he was bred. He's deeply muscled and heavily shouldered, capable of rapid speed and the ability to stand stock still one moment and to run full out the next. With King Leo Barr and Randy Dunham, we see the unique relationship between a man and his horse. This is Bob Switzer in Ghost Lake, Alberta.
West now, across the Rockies, into British Columbia, and to the edge of the Pacific Ocean.
This is Mike Winlaw on the shores of the Pacific Ocean at Vancouver. This is Kitsilano Beach, where the time is 19 minutes past 12 noon. And it's a beautiful day. Bright sunshine, the temperature 78 degrees. Great weather for a Sunday afternoon at the beach. Across the warm sands and just a few short steps away, the blue Pacific. Water temperature today, close to 70 degrees. To the west, several hundred yards past the swimming area, the Kitsilano and Vancouver Yacht Clubs. And all the Sunday sailors are out today. Farther west, beyond the brightly colored sails, our friends on the rim of the Pacific. It's 12:20. Pacific Daylight Time.
A Scottish hillside farm on a fine summer's evening, yet only 14 miles from the teeming city of Glasgow. But on the hillside opposite, a new way of life, very different from the cubist honeycomb of habitat. This is Magnus Magnusson reporting from the prize-winning new town of Cumbernauld. Eventually, 70,000 will come here from Scotland's older cities. This visionary town is only one-third complete, but already part of the vision has been realized here. In the town center, you can shop in peace and safety. When finished, it'll be five times this size, with room for 5,000 cars to be parked underneath. But one tier up, the first shops have opened, and there's not a car in sight. Here you are free of the monster. This is a town where the average age is only 24. Women and children have been given priority, and of the present population of 24,000, over a third is under 15 years old. By 2000 AD, the children now 7 or 8 will be 40 years old. Now, how do these 7 or 8 year olds see their town when they're grown-ups with families of their own? Local primary school children drew these pictures for us, their vision of their town. For motorists, a road network loops Cumbernauld. Complex interchanges take you to the housing areas. From up here, it looks rather like a child's toy. But in this town, the children are free from traffic danger. In a housing area like Seafar, it's people who count. Mothers and children have the run of cobbled paths from which the car is banned. They are safely parked behind the houses. Each community has its own village shop. This is the genius of Cumbernauld. Into a new town, planners have built all the calm of an old world village. What you can't buy here, you'll be able to buy in the town center, nowhere more than 20 minutes walk away. Houses for the workers of Cumbernauld can be bought for £3,000 to £5,000 each, but you can rent a three-bedroomed house for as little as 35 shillings per week, depending on your income. Mr. John Colley and his wife Annie and their two daughters came here from Glasgow 5 years ago to this split-level, all-electric house. Mrs. Colley works as a shorthand typist. Her husband is an insurance agent. Their combined income is about £30 a week, from which only one-tenth is spent on rent and rates for their home. Work has come to Cumbernauld's new factories from other parts of Britain, some even from America. New industries are springing up, and with first-class roads linking two major seaports nearby, Cumbernauld sees its future trading and exporting between America and the European common market. This Sunday shift is in a timber window frame factory, and Cumbernauld is also developing electronics and other science-based industries. But here at Cumbernauld Centre, the architects have built for living and pleasure. Below these penthouses will be a bowling alley, theatres, cinema. And in this new hotel in the town centre, at just about 9:10 on a Sunday evening, only 14 miles but a whole world away from the crowds and the noise and the dirt that they knew in Glasgow, the new people of the new town enjoy the best of city as well as village life.
This is our world. Will we find a way of living on it together, or will we perish under the weight of our ever-increasing numbers? We cannot tell. But the best hope lies in recognizing the challenge, because something in the nature of our species has always sought a challenge and responded to it. We've responded to the challenge of our world. In 1953, men climbed its highest mountain, Mount Everest, 29,000 feet high. In 1960, man penetrated even further downwards, 35,800 feet into the Marianas Trench. Man reached the North Pole in 1909 and the South Pole in 1911. Sailed round the world alone in 226 days. Man has jumped to a height of 7.5 feet, pole vaulted a height of 17.5 feet. In 1961, he reached 9 miles up in a glider. In 1963, he reached 67 miles up in an aeroplane. In 1966, two astronauts reached 830 miles in a satellite. We have responded to the challenge to go faster. Man has reached a running speed of 26.22 miles an hour, 42.193 kilometers, a water speed of 276 miles an hour, 527 kilometers, a land speed of 632 miles an hour, an air speed of 1,429 miles an hour, an orbiting speed of 17,750 miles an hour, 28,876 kilometers an hour. There are many places in the world where survival itself is a challenge, but even in the industrialized world where the battle for survival is won, men go on setting themselves new challenges, enduring pain and exhaustion, risking injury and death. And not because they must, but because they choose to, because there is a restless unsatisfaction in the heart of man. In that dissatisfaction lies our hope. Let us look now, on this June day of 67, at some of our fellow men and women who are at this moment striving to achieve that excellence. Many of them would say they do it to enjoy themselves.
Good afternoon. I'm Ted Reynolds in Vancouver, Canada. Here on the West Coast, it's just before 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We are at the Empire Pool. This pool was built in 1954 for the Commonwealth Games. It is 55 yards in length because Commonwealth events are run in yards. The water temperature is 79 degrees. The air temperature is 78 degrees Fahrenheit. Here is 16-year-old Elaine Tanner with her coach, Howard Furby, who's preparing his team for the 1967 Pan American Games in Winnipeg, Canada. Elaine, holder of 30 Canadian records, winner of 4 gold medals at the 1966 Commonwealth Games, will attempt a world record swim in the 110-yard butterfly. She already holds the world record at 220 yards. The listed world record for the 110 yards is 1 minute, 5.1 seconds held by Ada Koch of the Netherlands. To make this an official world record attempt, we have these officials, a turn judge, a stroke judge, we have a starter and a referee. On the left of your screen, the turn judge is Ted Schutman. The stroke judge is Jack Ford. The referee is Alan Harvey. And the starter is Jack Pomper. We have four officials timing this swim. On your left, Don Dunphy, Mrs. Miles Schutman, Mrs. Dorothy Kronk, and the head timer, Mr. Jack Kelly. So we're ready. And now here's the referee, Alan Harvey.
Timers and judges ready. Swimmer up. Mr. Starter.
110 yards, butterfly, two lengths of the pool. Take your mark.
Remember that the world record is 1 minute 5.1 seconds. The time you are seeing is an unofficial timing. He wants a split time of about 31 seconds, and we will get an unofficial split time for you. That is when she makes the turn and heads for home. And she's going at a very, very fast time. That is an unofficial time, very probably incorrect. We'll try and get a slip time for you. An unofficial slip time, 32 seconds, which means she has to bring it home very, very fast. The crowd here is cheering her on. Remember, that world record is 105.1. And she is certainly going to be awfully close to it. Unofficial, we have 106.6, and I'm just going to speak briefly with her coach, Howard Furby. Howard, that's still an amazing time, 106.6.
Yeah, she went out just a little bit too slow.
A little bit too slow. What did she have to do?
About 30.2, 30.3 on the way.
And she was about 32, was she?
Something like that, yeah.
I think perhaps now we can get the time from the 106.6. It is just shy of the world record, 106.6. Elaine? You got enough breath to come out here just for a second? Elaine, it was still a great swim, and you got those Pan American Games coming up in Winnipeg.
Yeah, well, I'll try it again there.
Very good, Elaine. Congratulations. Thanks for a wonderful show. The time was 106.6, and that's it from Vancouver.
This is Alberto Jubilo. It's almost 10 o'clock Italian time, and I speak from the riding center of Castellazzo de Bollate, large riding ring. The Dinseo brothers are training here for the Olympics. This is Piero Dinseo that we're looking at the moment. We're going to show how the two brothers, Piero and Raimondo, cooperate in their training. You'll hear Raimondo advising Piero as he goes round over the obstacles. The first obstacle was 1.4 meters high. The triple obstacle is 1 meter 50. Piero Dinseo, one of the most popular horse riders, show jumpers, with British television viewers, of course. 44 years old, known the world over. These are the two horses that they're hoping to ride at the Olympic Games in Mexico City. Not quite fully mature yet, but this is as it should be, coming up for next year, for full pitch. There you see how easily she copes with that obstacle, shaping up very well. No trouble with that one. Little advice coming from Raimondo, I don't know whether you can hear it. She seems very sure of how she's coping with these obstacles. And a rewarding pat from Piero. And there we see Raimondo advising him. A little more gently, perhaps, he's saying. Now we'll see. See the other brother going over the same course, riding a French horse. Quatre temps, the name of this one. Hoping for great things. They've been without really first-class horses for some time, and of course this is a great problem with the Olympics coming up next year. This is why they're hoping for great things from these two. Piero asked Raimondo if he wanted a longer stirrup. He said no, he's quite happy, he's done the first vertical obstacle. Now here's Catreton coming up to the second obstacle. No trouble there. That's 1.50 meters high. Lovely to see these horses. No trouble there either. Marvelous hindquarters this one has. 1.60 meters. Not exceptional heights, but all part of the training program. Remarkable perhaps for a covered riding ring. Piero is enthusiastic about the way his horse presents itself to the obstacle.
Ancora un ostacolo positivo per Raimondo Vinzeo.
Here comes one more for Raimondo. Over that without any difficulty. Here he comes for the triple bars, 1.70 meters. Over without any difficulty at all. The brothers training together, helping each other in a true sporting spirit.
Here we are at Söderfors in Sweden, an industrial community, 140 kilometers north of Stockholm. I am Christina Hansegård, and the time now is 9 o'clock. Our factory is about 300 years old, carrying on a very old industrial tradition, which started with a family business, but today, it is concentrating on stainless steel. Gert Fredriksson is 47 years old, one of the fastest and really best canoeists, but he's having difficulties here, you can see, with these treacherous rapids. It's not the first time he's been in. We have someone stationed on shore who will save him, we hope. He's been at this all afternoon, but he considers it very dangerous because there are rocks which are unseen, and they're rare where he is now. You've got to have lightning quick reactions, but never lose your calmness or your presence of mind to negotiate this turbulent stream. This is Gert Fredriksson. He has 6 Olympic gold medals. Now, this is Gunnar Utterberg. Oh, it looks as if we're... They're both in the water now. Oh, they're off to fetch Gerd Fredriksen. They're doing about 10 knots, which is equal to 7 knots in a straight line. Lars Andersson is the youngest of the group. He's 19. He's Söderfors's champion. He's done this several times, this course. Of course, he's often been in two. And no trip is ever the same twice. Oh, he is also capsized. Now, the one still up is Rolf Pettersson, 23. Now, there are great hopes for him. No world records have been beaten in Söderfors here, but they did have a go in Canada, but anyway, we hope to succeed next time. There's certainly been a tremendous amount of drama today, and our four canoeists have been doing their best to negotiate these turbulent rapids. Now we say goodbye from Söderfors. The time is 9 o'clock, 9:03.
This is Michel Perigard at Calonne. And I'm showing you this picture of Marseille. I'm not going to show you a sport event, as in Sweden or Italy. And yet today is a great first night. It is really something quite special. At 9:04, a new monster. About 15 kilometers off Marseille, the first time this monster, the Telescope, will go right down with a passenger on board into the Mediterranean. The Mediterranean, it is now quite a fine occasion. The cold weather seemed to come along on purpose for this experience. The telescope is the latest invention of man to enable anyone, but anyone, to go down. You can go down, I can go down, right to the submarine depths. The sort of depths which we were reminded about at the beginning of this broadcast. For 7 minutes I've been swinging on this cable, which goes down slowly. The sea fauna and flora was reserved for these fishmen who were doing a kind of a ballet around me, and I must say it was quite reassuring to see them. Today I am the first passenger of the telescope. So, as you can see, without the least difficulty, in a lounge suit, I can make the strange discoveries of this novel world around me. I can look round greedily at this strange and bizarre life which I can see around me.
La mer n'est pas morte.
because the sea is far from being empty, far from being dead. It's inhabited by a really intense life for those who come down to the depths of the sea like me for the first time. And if for some moment for you to see this kind of curious contact between this octopus and these men round the cabin. These creatures looked tough, because after all I was wrong when I thought that it was this underwater life. I was going to find nothing 10 meters under the sea. It's been exactly the other way about. It is the submarine life underwater which comes and looks at me. Poor me, lost in my aquarium, or rather my aerium. Never mind. What has happened today is a new legend to add to the many legends of the sea. I am trusted to the mermaids and the sirens, so let them go and tell it to the four corners of the earth.
These are some of the challenges that just a few of our vast human family are setting themselves on this June day in the late 1960s, and already the family is larger, 15,000 new babies since we started. But man has not only stretched the powers of his body, he also strives restlessly to stretch his mind and his spirit. There are still 60% of us who cannot read, but the 40% who can read represent a tremendous effort and a tremendous increase in this century, even in the last 20 years. And never has there been so much for them to read. Every year there are over 400,000 different book titles published. Every day there are 300 million copies of the world's 9,000 daily papers. For those who don't want to pay for them, there are 700,000 libraries to read them in or borrow them from. Musical composers publish 128,000 pieces a year, one every 40 minutes. Record companies press 900 million records a year, so every second there are 10 more discs. There are 231,000 cinemas in our world, containing seats for 74 million people. 12,000 million people pay to watch each year, about 4 visits on average for every man, woman and child in our world. We produce nearly 3,000 new feature films every year, 8 each day. Most of us are happy to look and listen and enjoy. But a few spend their lives creating shapes and designs to enlarge our vision of the world. They strive to express mind and spirit in earth and metal to crystallize imagination in permanence. So once more we look briefly around our world at a few of the people in whose excellence we find our delight and whose work is our pleasure.
Questa è la chiesa romanica di San Pietro.
This is the Romanesque church of San Pietro, built in the 7th century. My name is Della Bassani from Italian radio and television, and we've come to this Etruscan city, which is 80 kilometers from Rome, because even on Sundays, at 11 minutes past 10, the cinema is working. Franco Zeffirelli, that well-known Shakespearean director, is rehearsing the first few scenes of his next film, Romeo and Juliet. Here we are inside the church, and we see the director, Franco Zeffirelli, giving the first instructions to Milo O'Shea, who's playing Friar Lawrence.
Accanto a lui, il giovanissimo protagonista Leonard Whiting, di 16 anni.
Next to Zeffirelli, the very young 16-year-old Leonard Whiting, who's playing Romeo.
Nothing good can be reached, no peace can be reached, unless through the love of innocent creatures. This is one of the great contemporary values of that this tragedy offers us. And indeed, I wish that many responsible people in the world would keep that in mind. Anyway, he has closed the door, shut the door, and the church is empty, and that's dark. Romeo is there. He's all in thought and feelings are anticipating the moment that Juliet will arrive and marry her. Of course, the friar tries to put a break on what... Now, will you please go through the dialogue 1 second? I speak with the camera.
Yes. Ora Zeffirelli si rivolge al direttore della fotografia, Pasqualino De Santis.
Now, as you see, Zeffirelli goes to the cameraman.
Posare segretamente i due. Ha chiuso la porta principale. Lui ha un piano in mente.
Gives the exact instructions to the cameraman and tells him just what the particular plot of the scene that he wants to do will be. He tells him the shots that he will want, just how he wants them. The wedding scene. Fra Lawrence marrying the young Romeo and Juliet. Whiting is the 16-year-old Londoner. Juliet is played by 15-year-old Olivia Hussey. It's the first time, in fact, that real teenagers have played these parts in a stage production. There we see Olivia Hussey, the new 1967 Juliet.
Hold on a minute. This is a very important moment because the first time you see Romeo after the balcony scene, which only took place a few hours before. So it was all in a dream, you know, a dreamlike planet, and now it becomes true. So your first instinct is to kiss him. He's my man. He's going to be my husband in a minute. Stavo dicendo che questo è un momento importantissimo perché loro si sono visti la sera precedente al ballo, si sono visti dopo, sono passati tutta la notte insieme nel balcone, si sono promessi.
Terribly important moment this. They've seen each other at the ball, they promise each other eternal love. This is the first time they come down to reality.
Si ritrovano, il primo impulso è quello di unirsi. Ma il frate, questo non lo può permettere. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Let's go around. Good evening, my ghostly confessor.
La scena è quella del matrimonio.
Juliet, if the measure of thy joy be heat like mine, and if thy skill be more to praising it, and sweeping of thy breath its neighbouring.
They are but beggars that can count their worth, but my true love is grown to such excess, I cannot sum up some of half my wealth.
John!
Come with me. We will make short work, for by your leaves we shall not stay alone. The Holy Church and corporate two in one.
Hold it. Now, come. Ecco, sta per. Questo è un primo piano. Un bel primo piano con tutta la chiesa dietro. Eh? Look at the crucifix. And crucifix. And then follow. Now look at them. Yes, that's good. As if they were two masterpieces of nature.
Naughty boy, eh? Non si vede.
Flowers. Now, love. Fire watches. Shh. With the corner of your eyes, look at one another. Look at one another. Guido and Papa get serious. This is the moment you are taken by kind of fear. Now they can kiss.
long kiss. Thank you very much. Now, there are several things, because we have to cut it in, you know, various moments. Now, we'll do it all in one first.
Yes.
We'll do all in one.
Yes.
Just to have the flow of the scene.
Yes.
And then I will add several, you know, photographic tricks. Let's go back.
Yes, and this is Germany, with romantic German opera music. And a very, very hot evening it is. It is 20 minutes past nine. And here they're rehearsing Lohengrin with an enormous orchestra, 92 musicians, under Rudolf Kempe. From the Munich Philharmonic Orchestra. For the first time since 1962, Lohengrin is going to be presented at Bayreuth, the Bayreuth Festival Theatre. And a change is expected. Wolfgang Wagner, who is directing, is always stormy, and this evening particularly so. But now he's going on stage to his international cast, the heroine played by Heather Harper and the dark evil woman by Grace Hoffman from Ohio in the United States. On too late, do it again. You must keep time. Well, once again.
It hails.
Well, we've got exactly what we wanted. The king has been hailed. And a great many hails will have to be said here in Bayreuth until the first night, but a lot of time is left. And even today, a few more hours are going to be used in rehearsal. However, for the benefit of the cast, Wolfgang Wagner has just introduced a smoking pause, which we can all do with. The storm that has been promised hasn't happened yet, so hail and farewell from Bayreuth.
Inaugurating 3 years ago the Might Foundation, André Malraux said, "Here something has been attempted which has never been attempted before, to create by instinct and love a world in which modern art could find at the same time its place and that world which used to be called the supernatural." The costumes from this ballet were created by Alexander Calder, who is here next to his statue. Now, the figures and sculptures of Alberto Giacometti. The statement of Calder, or the question of Giacometti. Art bears witness that there's always in the heart of man a desire to get beyond the world, beyond reality. There's a feeling of space which stresses the mystery of the night as we go up from the labyrinth conceived by Miro. His great fork does more than blend in with the countryside, it transforms it. Here, the dancer moves and meets his partner in a form of the goddess, the symbol of fertility. And as in the old mysteries and rites, together they rejoin the group who dance around the ark. In this labyrinth, it looks as though rather than lose himself, man rediscovers something, something like contact with the elements, air, earth and fire, which here Miro has combined together. Near the pool, where George Braque's fish sleep, we go into one of the rooms of Fondation Night. Here you can see a canvas called In the Black Circle, painted by Cecily Kandinsky, 1923. Voici une des grandes compositions de Bonnard. This is one of the great works of Bonnard, Summer, where all the painter's sensual love of form and colour is expressed.
Vous voyez maintenant cette
toile intitulée Autour de Bonnard.
Now you see a canvas called Around France by Marc Chagall, the painter of memories and metamorphoses. In the dreams of Chagall, love and tenderness hold first place. And this language can be understood by all men. For all men, Alexander Calder has made this sculpture, which he marks with his signature and peace. Calder and Miro, they come from different countries, but meeting tonight together and with you.
I am Michelin, I'm speaking from Mexico. This is the Mexican Telesystem Unit, which is recording a program of folk music for our country. This program is called A Salam from Mexico and takes 4 minutes. So we shall see how Mexico makes its music. Mexico, where the Olympic Games will be held in 1968. Thank you, goodbye.
This is the plaza of Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts in New York City. This weekend, the dominant theme in its theaters is music. If all the sounds from these buildings were unleashed, the noise of the city would be overwhelmed by the creations of the hundreds of performers gathered for the center's International Festival 67. This weekend in the Metropolitan Opera House, the Middle Theater, the festival is presenting the Hamburg State Opera. This afternoon, the opera has moved across the plaza for a special concert performance on the stage of Philharmonic Hall, the home of the oldest symphony orchestra in America, the New York Philharmonic. At this moment, in a room at the top of the building, a special musical event is being prepared for next Wednesday night. Philharmonic conductor Leonard Bernstein is rehearsing Rachmaninoff's third piano concerto. The soloist is Van Cliburn. The third piano concerto was given its world premiere by the New York Philharmonic in 1909. The conductor at that time was Gustav Mahler. The soloist, Rachmaninoff himself.
This moment, where we just arrived, it's marked Schumann, so you hold back there.
I like it a little better. Where you hold back. I know, but it sounds better when against the orchestra, so you can hear. And then also you get.
The forward motion, if we could get both of those by holding
this
back.
Let's try it one more time. From
can we hold this back a little
all
bit?
All right, be glad to.
Then the più mosso is easier to make.
Then we'll do it one bar again from where one bar before 22.
Five. We didn't hold back enough before it.
You see, if these are the bells, the old church bells.
Yes, but they don't have to go so fast.
But I didn't think that was so terribly fast. That wasn't any faster than we were going
in
the theme.
Just hold that a little bit.
All right, let's do it one more time.
One last time.
Good.
Can be misurato in this place. Yeah. Oh, it's going to be beautiful.
Oh, I hope.
Can we do passage of the second movement.
Maybe at the più vivo?
The first part will be fine. That'll be all right. Could we go just before 29?
29, all right.
Well, yes.
All right, fine. Direct?
Yeah. Thank you.
This is Steve Race in the Beatles recording studio in London, where the latest Beatle record is at this moment being built up. Not just a single performance, but a whole montage of performances. With some friends in to help the atmosphere, this is quite an occasion.
Very good, thank you, John. That's fine. I think that will do for the vocal backing very nicely. We'll get the musicians in now, and we'll do the last take.
Oh, great.
Okay. Run back the tape, please, Richard.
There's several days' work on that tape. For perhaps the 100th time, the engineer runs it back to the start for yet another stage in the making of an almost certain hit record. The supervisor is George Martin, the musical brain behind all the Beatles records. There's the orchestra coming into the studio now, and you'll notice that the musicians are not rock and roll youngsters. The Beatles get on best with symphony men. The boys began by making a basic instrumental track on their own. Then they added on top of that a second track of vocal background, and they've just added a third track. Now comes the final stage. It brings in a solo vocal from John Lennon, and for the first time, the orchestra. Here then is final mixed track, take one, of a song which we offer to the whole world. All You Need Is Love.
All right, we're ready? Let's go for it then. Hands on musicians, please. Get them on. All right, here we go then. We'll send the tape. Are you ready, Richard?
Just coming.
Okay, Jeff?
Yep.
All right, here we go.
Okay, Richard?
Here comes the tape.
Watch it.
Thank you.
Past 100 minutes, our cameras have been bringing you direct live pictures of people and places from widely separated parts of the Earth's surface. Now, as our program draws towards its end, we look beyond our world. Our world is a tiny planet orbiting the sun in the cold, dark emptiness of space. The sun is one of 10,000 million, million, million stars in the detectable universe. This television picture can go round the Earth in a fraction of a second, would reach the Sun in 8 minutes, but would not reach the nearest star, Proxima Centauri, until September 1971, when our babies born today might be starting to read and write. Could there be other worlds like ours? Most astronomers think there could, perhaps even many thousands others, all capable of supporting life, orbiting round other stars like our Sun. We will never visit them, nor will the babies born today. But we are already 10 years into the space age. Men will land on the moon before our babies are very old. They are children of the space age. Let us see what we can show them today beyond our world, and how people on our world are at this moment preparing to visit the inhospitable moon.
Kennedy Space Center on the east coast of Florida. The time is 4:45 in the afternoon. And this is Dr. Kurt Debus, a man with a 27-year-old dream and the opportunity to make it come true. He's a quiet and precise man, a lover of classical music who builds his own hi-fi equipment and listens to it. He's a graduate mechanical and electrical engineer, born in Frankfurt, Germany, 59 years ago. He came to the United States in 1945. He's married, has two grown daughters, and like most of us, is deeply involved in the community where he lives. Like the man, the community is little known to the public, but it's a very special community. It's Cocoa Beach, Florida, about 125 miles north of Miami. The reason Cocoa Beach and Kurt Debus are special is the Kennedy Space Center. Cocoa Beach is next to it. Dr. Debus runs it for the National Aeronautics and Space Administration.
We have no leaks.
At the moment, he's in firing room one at the Kennedy Moonport's Launch Control Center. And even though it's Sunday afternoon, people are here working. Dr. Debus is with Rocco Petrone, his director of launch operations. This afternoon, like so many other weekend afternoons during the past few months, the two of them are here, checking and rechecking the incredibly intricate procedures and timetable for the next launch. This one coming up is a special thrill for Kurt Debus. He's been waiting for it for 27 years. Waiting and working to make it come true. It's the first test flight of the Saturn V Apollo spacecraft, the vehicle that, before 1970, will take man to the moon. I'm David Prowitt of NET, and this is the dream, or at least the bottom part of it. That's all you can see because of the work platforms. The crew that's here today is working to get the Saturn V rocket and the Apollo spacecraft together and functioning. That's what's been going on here for weeks now. Hundreds of highly skilled technicians and scientists trying to assemble this 365-foot miracle. These are the engines Dr. Debus has been waiting for, five of them, delivering 7.5 million pounds of thrust to boost the three-man Apollo spacecraft off the face of the Earth. Dr. Debus needed something special just to house his baby, so he helped design a home for it, this giant vehicle assembly building. Its doors are large enough to slide the UN building through them. As a matter of fact, you could put four UN buildings inside and still have room to spare. Now, in a sense, Dr. Debus needed a baby carriage, so he had one made. It's the size of a football field, and it weighs 2,500 tons. He calls it the crawler, And that's just what it does. Crawls, carrying 6,000 tons of rocket, spacecraft, and mobile launcher 3 miles from the biggest building in the world to launch pad 39. That's the spot where, about 3 months from now, the rocket will be hurled into space on the first of at least 3 test flights to pave the way for the lunar astronauts. But a dream of this size doesn't happen alone. During the years that he's run the Kennedy Space Center, Dr. Debus has assembled a hand-picked group of people, specialists in every phase of the space trade, experts in telemetry, exotic fuels, flight control. This is the team he's put together here to help him send an astronaut to the moon within the next 2 years. Some of these men have been with him since he made his first launch from Cape Kennedy in 1953. At that time, he likes to recall, the whole spaceport was made up of one tiny launching pad and one Quonset hut set in the middle of a Florida swamp. Today, less than 15 years later, that Quonset hut has expanded into a 114,000-acre spaceport. In a way, Dr. Debus helped to make this television program possible. It was from this spot, Pad 17, that his team launched the Early Bird and Lanny Bird communication satellites in 1965. These are the same satellites that are carrying the pictures and sound of our world to 26 countries across the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. And now, within the next 120 days, he'll watch the first Saturn V Apollo test vehicle boost into space, carrying with it the confidence of the people here at the Kennedy Space Center, the work of scientists and technicians of many countries, and the dream of Kurt Debus to find a new frontier for man on the moon.
As man prepares to venture into outer space, his knowledge of the universe is also being extended by the efforts and the devices of those working on the surface of our world. This is the radio telescope at Parkes, Australia, in the heart of great farmlands 200 miles from the Pacific Ocean. Day and night, cloudy or clear, the astronomers here study the radio signals from stars countless billions of miles away. The sun here is still below the eastern horizon, and it's a cold and fine morning here as the astronomers are preparing to take us on a voyage to the limits of the universe, a trip to the edge of time. We hope soon to receive signals from the most distant object known to man. I'm Kim Corcoran, and I'm in the control room of the radio telescope. All this complex, sensitive equipment here is needed to magnify the feeble signals from the universe for us to see and to hear them shortly. Dennis Gill over there drives the 1,000 tons of steel and concrete simply by pushing buttons. Controlling our experiment is John Bolton, one of the world's top radio astronomers. Late last year, John Bolton discovered the object we're just preparing to observe. It has no name, just a catalog number, 0237-23, but it's no ordinary star. It probably has more energy than any other object in the universe. On this star map, here is the Milky Way, and here the Southern Cross. And the quasar that we're talking about is somewhere here in these regions of the southern sky. And even on this greatly enlarged photograph, it's this mere insignificant speck here. But now the great dish is beginning to move across the sky. And to give you some idea of what's happening, this spot represents the dish as it moves across the sky. And when it reaches our object, 0237-23, we should receive the radio signals shown on a chart like this. This might not seem very dramatic, but when the mechanical pen on the chart of John Bolton's recorder starts to shiver its way up to the right, and when we hear a hissing noise, we'll be seeing live the signals from something 10,000 million, 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 million miles away, the furthest reach of human experience. So now, let's watch.
Increase the right center drive rate to 1 degree a minute, please, Dennis.
Driving 1 degree a minute, John.
Right center markers on 1 minute intervals.
1 minute RA markers, right.
What's the first marker?
The next marker will be 0237.
Declination?
Minus 23, 17.5.
Put the digital recorder on, please.
And there it was. So since you came to Park such a short time ago, the object giving those signals, quasar 0237 minus 23, has been rushing away from us so fast that it has gone a further 40 million miles.
The vastness of space is beyond our understanding. Our fate will not be decided among the distant stars. We will decide it for ourselves on this small planet, which is all we can comprehend. Let us, the millions of us now watching together, turn our thoughts back from the cold, silent spheres and think for a moment of our own world as it turns in the steady rhythms of day and night, cloud and sunshine. The world whose future we are putting in danger simply by living on it. More mouths to feed in the world than when we started 2 hours ago. That's our problem. It cannot be solved on the cold moon. It must be solved here on the warm, fertile earth by people. People like Ron Coldwell in Wisconsin who keep on trying to gather richer harvests from the land they live on. Or people like Lloyd Evans and his research team in Canberra. Be solved as long as people go on facing challenges and aspiring to bend the elements to their wills. As long as people go on creating some new picture or sound or music to enlarge our vision of the world, to stretch our minds and to delight us. It will be solved if people can live in crowded cities and towns and still feel that they have room to breathe and be alone. It is a problem which all of us on the face of this globe must solve together. In the last 2 hours of one revolution of this planet Earth, television viewers in 24 countries have united to watch this program. And television organizations in 14 countries have united to produce it. It may not be a spectacular achievement, but it is a step in the right direction. After all, none of us has to travel to the moon, but all of us have to live on our world.